Hello, church family. How are we all doing this morning? We're good. I can see your eyes smiling, if they are smiling. And I can see thumbs up, so that's good. Welcome here this morning. My name is Sonia, and I'm going to talk to you all this morning about love. I'm expecting significant levels of participation from everybody this morning. Yes? We up for this? Good. I'm glad. It's not optional. To get warmed up, we're going to play a festive game. Okay? We're going to play a festive version of Would You Rather. It's really easy to play this game. So all you need to do is, when I give you the options, you need to decide which of the options you would rather. I'll give you a moment to think. Thinking time. And then I'll ask for hands up for which option you've gone for. You're allowed to confer, but you don't need to be influenced by the people around you. Okay? So, first one is, would you rather live in a house made of gingerbread or have a candy cane the size of a Christmas tree? Think about it. Think about it. What's the person next to you thinking? Let's see, hands up for you want to live in a house made of gingerbread. Hands up for if you want a Christmas tree-sized candy cane. Okay, even fairly even split. Let's go, next option. Would you rather have a nose that glows like Rudolph or have a nose made out of a carrot like a snowman? What are we going for, flashing red nose or carrot? Discuss. Who wants a nose that glows? Who wants a nose made out of a carrot? Yeah, a few less gone for that. It's not functional, really, is it, as a nose? You could imagine a flashing red nose might still be able to... Anyway, okay, let's have the next options. Would you rather... Now, this is a negatively framed one. Would you rather never listen to Christmas music ever again? Or... Don't get too excited. Or never watch Christmas movies ever again? Think about it. Where it's not supposed to be hard. Oh. Also, these images represent the reason why it's so hard. Who would rather never listen to Christmas music ever again? Wow. Okay. Who would rather never watch Christmas music movies ever again? It's tough. I don't know what I'd choose. Next one. Would you rather have hair made out of tinsel? This is a permanent thing. Have hair, okay. Would you rather have hair made out of tinsel or wear a Santa hat every day? Right, think about it. Who would rather have permanently hair made out of tinsel? some strong commitment here. And anyone would rather wear a Santa hat every day? More options for Santa hat. Santa hat in the summer, though? I don't know. Tinsel in summer might be bad as well. Last one. This is telling, and I think people are more polarized on this one. Are you a stay inside in my jammies all day, snuggled up with a blanket, or outside in the fresh air snowball fight? What are you thinking? Over the festive season, do you want to be mostly inside or mostly outside? Hands up for inside, snuggled up, hot chocolate, blanket, PJs. Hands up for outside, snowball fight, fresh air, skiing, sledging. Oh my goodness, it's the extroverts. Okay. So some strong feelings about Christmas, right? There's things we love about Christmas. There's lots to love about Christmas. And to find out some more about Christmas, I'm gonna look in here. I could have gone to Disney movies, or I could have just watched, like, I don't know, the elephant love scene and the elephant love medley scene. It's really hard to write anything about love and not also mention everything in Moulin Rouge. But here we go. I'm going to the Bible. That's a safer option for today. Did you know that the Bible is actually kind of a love story? The Bible is lots of books, and it's poems, and it's letters, and it's songs, but they all point to the same idea. The Bible, the whole story of the Bible, is God's incredible love-fueled rescue mission for us, his beloved creation. And the birth of Jesus is part of that story. Actually, it's a huge part. Now, you see, I have watched all the Moulin Rouges, and I have watched all the Disney movies, and I know that if I was going to write a love story, I don't think I'd choose a long, uncomfortable journey on a donkey, would you? No. I don't think I'd choose stinky sheep and stinky shepherds, would you? I don't think I'd choose being born in a dirty old shed full of straw, would you? But here's the thing. God did choose all those things, and I think God knew what he was doing. God should know what he's talking about when it comes to love, because the Bible says God is love. God actually is love, a fully loving being. All of the journeying and the angels and the shepherds and the wise men and the star, they're all part of that story to show us how God loves us and how much he loves us. And actually, the story of Christmas is the story of God's love for us. You might know that God is a creator. The whole universe is his idea. And he is beyond anything we can imagine. The story of Christmas tells us that, yes, God is that incredible, powerful, infinite, almighty being out there. That's true, but he's also with us. He came to earth as a human to make his home among us. Isn't that amazing? You'd think that since we talk about love all the time, we'd know what we're talking about. But love can actually mean lots of different things. Some people might know that I'm a teacher. Some people might be able to tell from the last few minutes, but that's fine. I am a chemistry teacher, and I teach young people. Yes, represent. Okay. And I teach young people about things that are quite tricky to understand. One of the ways we can tell whether we understand something is to ask, what's the opposite of that thing? So let's try this. There's going to be a word on the screen in a second, and your job is to think about what the best opposite of that word is. And again, you're allowed to confer. So if the word on the screen was high, you might say low. If the word on the screen was light, you might say, or heavy. Oh, okay. Yeah, we're adding it. Okay, let's have the first one up on the screen. So don't say it out loud just yet, but just whisper to the person next to you. What do they think it means? If you've got a child next to you, you can read it what it says. If you don't have a child next to you, you can still read it what it says. What's the opposite of up? Down. Okay, good. Right. Okay, we understand the opposite of up is down. What's the opposite of open? Keep it quiet. What's the opposite of open? Okay, tell me what's the opposite of open? Closed. Did anyone have anything different? Yeah? Okay. Don't be difficult. What's the opposite of right? Okay, left or wrong could be. Okay, what's the next one? What's the opposite of fast? Classic Rehope answer. The opposite, it could be slow. It could be feast. Good. Next one, what's the opposite of go? Stop. Any others? Still? Stay? Come and go. Yeah. You're expecting this, but what is the opposite of love? Think about this. Ask the person next to you, what's the best opposite they can think of the word love? Mary, what's your idea? Sin. Yeah, okay. Wow. Do you want to come up here and do this? Yeah, any other ideas? Apathy. Yes, good. Apathy, like, can't he be bothered? Okay, we get that. Any other opposites of love? Hate. Thank you. Any other opposites of love? Selfishness. Any other opposites of love? Wow, disrespectful. We're going for it. Sadness. Anything else? Lonely, evil. Okay, wow, good. We're getting some different ideas of what the opposite of love might be. in a way, the opposite of love could be considered hate, right? Okay, so if on this side we've got a strong feeling of badness towards something, a strong feeling of evil towards something, then the opposite of that, as love, would be a strong feeling of goodness towards something. Love is about treasuring something and cherishing it and enjoying it. Some of you said things about the opposite of love that might be like more like fear. Okay? If fear is like being worried and being panicky and feeling uneasy and nervous and staying far away from something just in case something bad happens, then love, the opposite of that, is about peacefulness and being calm and being close. Love's trustworthy. You can rest in the presence of love. If we've got apathy, indifference, can't be bothered, if that's about not caring, not being bothered, then love is about being bothered. Love's about being interested. Love's energetic. Love is passionate. It's enthusiastic. It's committed. You might want to say, I don't want to cause any bother, but love's like, you never bother me. I care about you so much. Please tell me everything about how you are and how your day was and what your favorite ice cream flavor and anything else. I'm always listening. That's what love is like. Can I tell you something I've not told many people before? A few months ago, it was my birthday, and my husband, he's sitting over there, hi. He asked, this is truth, by the way. He asked my daughter, what does mummy love, right? Because they were planning to get me a gift for my birthday. Can anyone guess what she said? What did she say about what she thought I loved? Great, good ideas, good suggestions. Any other things that you thought mummy would love? Excellent. You're giving just more inspiration for next year. Good, good, good. Well, yes, apparently she replied, well, the truthful reply is mummy loves chocolate and looking at her phone. But we're not going to talk about the second part of that today because, you know, the Holy Spirit convicts in three or five-year-olds. We're just going to talk about chocolate. We're going to talk. I do love chocolate. I love chocolate. You too. You love it too. Anyone else in here love chocolate? Can I just describe to you how I feel about chocolate? I never want to be without chocolate. I find it really hard to share chocolate. But then I like giving it to other people so I can watch them eat it. I love chocolate. I want it to be close to me. I think it tastes incredible. I want to try all different kinds of chocolate. It's yummy and it's scrummy and it's sweet and it's good for you, for your mind at least. My question's this. Is God's love for us the same as my love for chocolate? Well, we're going to go back to the Bible because the Bible has a lot to say about what God's love is like. Let's look at the first thing the Bible's saying about what God's love is like. Okay. It says, he is, describing God, he is the faithful God who lavishes his unfailing love on those who love him and obey his commands. Do you know this word lavish? That makes me think of when Caleb puts his own squirty cream on his hot chocolate. And you have to tell him to stop, because if he didn't, the whole can would be on this hot chocolate. Lavish is like lots and lots and lots and lots and lots and lots and lots of, and it never ends. Okay, so there's a lot of God's love, right? Let's look at the next thing. One of the people in the Bible that tells people about what Jesus is like, he says, he's praying for people, and he says, may you have the power to understand how, and I'm sure anyone in We Hope can help me with the actions for this, how wide and long and, was long, and high, and deep his love is. Yeah, so God's love, it goes in all directions, in all dimensions. You can never get to the end of God's love. Okay, right, next one. For the Lord your God is living among you. He is a mighty Savior. He will take delight in you with gladness. With his love, he will calm all your fears. He will rejoice over you with joyful songs. God's love is powerful enough to change our fear into calmness and peace. That must be really powerful love. Let's look at the next one. Nothing in all creation can separate us from the love of God that's in Jesus. Love cannot be defeated. If we were playing top trumps and we were playing types of love, then the love that God has for us in Jesus would trump every other kind of love. It can't be defeated. It wins every time. God's love sounds pretty amazing to me. It sounds like a great love. Actually sounds like a perfect love. This is the thing, folks. We're getting the chocolate back out. Because I love chocolate. Thanks, Martha. Apart from Jesus. I love chocolate, but I've never done anything for chocolate. I just eat it. Yeah, I enjoy it. And I do feel strongly about it. And part of love is how we feel. But it's much, much more than that. Perfect love does things. Perfect love acts. And one of the biggest actions of love, of God's love, was coming to earth as a baby and living and dying for us. The first Christmas, God showed us how much he loved us. If I wanted to show the whole universe how big my love was, I don't know, I think I would do like fireworks show at minimum, right? Fireworks show. I would have symphony orchestras, huge choirs, huge choirs. At the very least, an all-you-can-eat buffet, confetti, live stream the whole thing so everyone can join in. It's not what God did. In God's perfect love story, in all of his infinite power and wisdom and glory, he chose to become a human. And he didn't like teleport into the earth as a super strong, muscly, tough guy ready to save the day. He was born as a tiny baby. Why would he do that? Because Jesus came to earth as a baby, we can trust that God actually knows what it's like to be a human. God knows what it's like to be happy and sad and to laugh and to cry and to feel all the things that we feel in our lives. God shows us how to live through Jesus. And if God is love, and if Jesus is God in human form, then we can know what love looks like when we look at the life of Jesus. One of the reasons Jesus was born was to show us what God is like. The Bible actually says that Jesus has revealed God to us. Or you could even think about Jesus has explained God to us. The tricky things about God make more sense when we look at Jesus. But there's still another question. Why would God, in all of his infinite power and wisdom and glory, choose to be born the way he did? In that stinky stable, in that leftover place, somewhere that was really only for animals. A king wouldn't be born in that way, surely. Would they? The God of the universe actually chose the most simple and humble and helpless of beginnings to show us that he came for everyone. He was born into a poor, ordinary family. In his life, Jesus often chose the difficult path to show us that he's near the poor and the needy and the helpless and all the tough things that we feel in our life. Jesus knows what that's like. We can trust that because that's actually what he chose to become. That's how he chose to reveal himself on earth. And folks, whether you're little or big, whether you've been at church lots, or this is your first time, or even your first time in a long time, actually, we all need the love and help of Jesus to be close to God the way he created us to be. And God knew that human beings were not making a good job of life without him. So Jesus was also born to rescue us with his love and his mercy and his kindness. I'm going to say some things over you that I believe God's love says. To help us concentrate and listen closely, maybe you could close your eyes just to listen. This is what God's love tells us. I created you. I know you. I care about you. I want good things to happen in your life. And I will help you, and I will guide you. I'll sustain you. I'll give you everything you need. I'll protect you, and I will always, always be with you. God, help us to trust in the goodness of your perfect love. Amen. I have one very simple challenge for you this week, and I think it's one that we can probably all do. It is celebrate Christmas. in all of the fun and the wonderful ways that you can. You see, the message of Christmas is good news of great joy for all people, whoever you are. And even if celebrations look a bit different for you this year, even if they're mixed in with some disappointment or doubt or grief, know that God's perfect love is with you, and it's for you. Thanks.